My name is Sarah Hall and I am the Visitor Services Manager here for the Red House Glasscone, which roughly translates as Site Manager. This building was built in 1797. It's a great historical building and essentially it was for the glassmaking trade. So you've got the huge cones, sort of 100 feet high. There were lots and lots of cones in Stourbridge because it was a centre of the glassmaking industry. Right. I mean, going as far back as the Huguenots. The reason being, you've got the canal networks to bring in all the raw materials and the coal. But one of the most significant reasons is you've got fire clay, which you can get very locally, which they use to make the pots to heat up the material to actually melt the glass. And you've got to get a clay that resists a really, really high temperature and doesn't crack.
Yes.
And round here, you've got that. So that's why you've got so much glass making in Stourbridge compared to perhaps, you know, Birmingham or anywhere else.
Yeah. So could you briefly explain sort of the process of making glass, or the traditional way of making glass here?
What would have happened would have been a team of four people. Nowadays you see just two people, like if it's mainly colourful, bright studio glass, but there would have been a team of four. So you've got the gaffer, the person in charge, who was responsible for the shaping of the whole piece. You've got the servitor and the foot maker. They would have shaped the glass, and you've got the taker in, probably the most junior member of the team, starting at the age of 14, and they all work together as a team to make the glass. When glass goes from very hot to very cold, it would shatter. So they call it's called the annealing process. So you've got to put it back into an oven and cool it down really, really, really slowly before it doesn't crack. And we've got what they call a lear here, where it would have trundled along on metal trays from one side of the lear to the other until it cooled down. And then, I mean, glass would then have been transported sort of all over the world via the canal work from Stourbridge.
Yes.
And if you've probably seen on the site, the Stuart family had a very, very strong connection with the White Star Line and the Stonia family in Liverpool, so they would have actually produced the tableware for the Titanic and all that, the White Star Lines as well.
Yes.
There's commemorative pieces and Art Deco, so depending on what, you know, sort of the fashion dictated during the period. Obviously, got what Stourbridge is very, very famous for is the cameo glassware, where you sort of the carving techniques and John North, and that's very important.
Yes,
yeah.
How would you, in your own words, say that the cone sort of used sort of in the Black Country flag, and how is it sort of a symbol of the local history here?
I think it's sometimes difficult to imagine how the skyline would have been littered with cones, really, to be honest. I mean, you know, it could have been completely different, 25 to 26 cones, all in a very, very small area.
The other day that you said that they've had sort of CBeebies here.
In fact, someone this morning has travelled all the way from the other side of Bedworth and Eton because they'd seen Mr. Bloom on
CBeebies.
And they wanted to, yeah. And we often get used as a backdrop because it's obviously quite an iconic building. If someone's, you know, in Stourbridge for a particular programme, we're in Stourbridge today, we're in front of the cone. But we'd be surprised just how, you know, all the different types of filming that we've had. So, like I say, the CBeebies, we've had Got One, Fashion Six from here. Great British Railways with Marco Portillo. So yeah, the cone gets used for quite, you know, and that's good in many ways. It's never underestimate the power of television. You can see someone.
No, definitely not.
You know,
no.
So somebody travelling for an hour here this morning, prompted by the fact that they wanted to go and see where Mr. Bloom would, you know.